Why now? Why the reconversion of Hagia Sophia from a museum into a mosque? Hello, everyone. I'm François Picard. Welcome to the France 24 debate. Turkey's President Recep Tayyip Erdoğan ordering a return to tradition for what's much more than just a tourist attraction in Istanbul, but a monument for the ages and, well, at times, the embodiment of a rivalry over history. It's been a high place of worship for Christians before the Ottoman takeover of 1453. How much does history truly matter on the banks of the Bosphorus, where Asia meets Europe? Some critics go as far as to brand this the second death of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, the founder of secular modern Turkey, who in 1934 turned Hagia Sophia into a museum. How much of it's about domestic politics, and how much about affirming Turkey's status as a regional power, whose rivalries these days extend far beyond neighboring Greece? With Ankara involved in Syria and now in Libya, that puts Erdoğan on a direct collision course with Arab rival Egypt, Egypt long occupied by the Ottomans. Today in the France 24 debate, we're looking at that reconversion of Hagia Sophia, and with us to talk about it, Mustafa Akyol, senior fellow at the Cato Institute think tank and the author of the forthcoming book, Reopening Muslim Minds, A Return to Reason, Freedom, and Tolerance. Thanks for joining us from Washington.
Thanks for having me. Thank you.
From Istanbul, Yusuf Erim, Turkey analyst for broadcaster TRT World. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me, Francois.
In Beirut, Jana Jabour is with us, lecturer at the French Political Science Institute, Sciences Po. How are you, Jana?
Thank you, Francois. I'm good. Thank you.
And joining us from London, he's a historian and travel writer. Welcome to the show, Henry Hopwood Phillips.
Hi there. Thanks for having me.
The France 24 debate, where you can join the conversation on Facebook and on Twitter, hashtag F24debate. Yeah, foreign leaders have been invited in for Friday's first prayers in, well, close to a century, 86 years, at Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. Alison Sargent has more.
Hundreds performed their evening prayers outside of Istanbul's Hagia Sophia, hours after celebrating the Turkish president's decision to declare the monument a mosque.
453'te İstanbul fethedildikten sonra burası cami olmuştur ve bunun hakları tamamen bizdedir. Kimseyi ilgilendirmez ve o yüzden de asıl olan
bu Müslümanlara fethin armağanı olan bir yerdir. Onun için böyle bir şeye mahal yoktur. Burası 500 sene cami olarak kalmıştır. Sadece bir kısa bir müddet müze olarak kullanıldı. İnşallah bundan sonra da kıyamete kadar da cami olarak kalacaktır ya.
The Hagia Sophia was built as a cathedral during the Christian Byzantine Empire in the 6th century. When the Ottomans took over Constantinople some 9 centuries later in 1453, they converted it into a mosque. It remained that way until 1935, when the founder of the Turkish Republic, Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, turned it into a museum, saying he wanted to offer the Hagia Sophia to all of humanity, a symbol of Turkey's new secular principles. Principles that analysts say President Erdoğan is now revising.
Erdoğan veut flatter son électorat musulman conservateur, et il veut aussi montrer aux Européens qu'il fait ce qu'il veut dans son espace national, et il veut aussi liquider d'une certaine façon l'héritage séculier de la Turquie, qui était celui de Mustafa Kemal Atatürk.
President Erdoğan said it will continue to be open to non-Muslim visitors. The monument is Turkey's most popular tourist site, welcoming over 3.7 million a year.
Mustafa Akyol, you wrote an opinion piece for the New York Times in which you write, for the broader Muslim world, Hagia Sophia is a reminder that our tradition includes both our everlasting faith and values, as well as a legacy of imperialism. The latter's a bitter fact of history, like Christian imperialism or nationalism.
Well, you can look at this from a few different angles. One is that it's a building in Turkey. Turkey has the legal right to define its status. The converting of the Hagia Sophia from a mosque in 1935 was a political decision, and this is a political decision as well. So it's nobody's business. That's one argument. There's some truth to that. I mean, this is Turkish sovereignty, yes. However, If this was a mere mosque that was turned into a museum that is being reconverted again, nobody would have an issue. The question is, and the problem is, Hagia Sophia is sacred not only for Muslims, but Christians. It was built by Christians for 1,000 years almost. It served as world's greatest cathedral. Then it became a mosque. So these two religious communities, Christians and Muslims, have emotional ties. It's sacred for them. It's important for them. That's why I'm among the people, a small minority in Turkey, who argued in the past 2 decades that if we are going to reopen Hagia Sophia to worship, it should be for Muslims, but Christians should be given a share as well. You can arrange the building accordingly. Muslims can pray on Fridays, Saturdays, Sundays can be for Christians. Of course, this is not a very popular idea in Turkey because there's a heavy dose of religious nationalism. And I worry that this will make a lot of Muslims happy who pray there. I would pray there myself as a Muslim. However, Christians, especially Eastern Christians, are feeling offended. And that is not a good message for the world. So I find the political decision politically and legally valid, but I don't think it's wise. And what is interesting is that President Erdogan himself said this 2 years ago when he was asked about Hagia Sophia. He said, the people who ask for this don't know about the world. What will happen to our mosques around the world? He was meaning that a move like this can provoke anti-Muslim sentiments around the world, which is a real concern. Unfortunately, he changed his mind. I don't know why, probably Turkey's political context. But in the New York Times article, I also wanted to highlight the fact that converting churches into mosques is in fact even a controversial decision in Islam. It's not that Muslims came and converted every temple they found. In Jerusalem, Christian churches weren't touched. In many places in the Arab world, they weren't. Then the Ottomans used a legal justification to convert some churches, not all. So even the legacy there is complicated, and Islam has a history of tolerance. And I think Turkey would serve itself and the world better if that tolerance was the key aspect here. Some recent moves in Turkey have been good in that sense. I mean, a great synagogue was opened in Edirne, a Bulgarian church in Istanbul. So it would be wrong to see everything as black and white. But when it comes to Hagia Sophia, a pluralistic ideal could have been preserved. But unfortunately, that has not been the case.
Yeah, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan changing his mind indeed. This was him speaking a few days ago.
Those who do not take steps to prevent hostility against Islam and foreigners in their countries attack Turkey's will to use its sovereign rights. The decision to convert Hagia Sophia into a mosque again is the result of our own steadfastness.
Henry Hopwood Phillips, listening to Turkey's president, how do you explain it?
I think this is a guy who's effectively taken Turkish foreign policy from zero problems with all its neighbors to zero friends to keep up his kind of aggressive nationalist ideology. He's kind of converted everybody around him into, if not strangers, actually being actively hostile towards them and seeing them negatively in that way. I mean, you only have to look to its northern border with Russia to see it's effectively got a kind of trinket of proxy wars going on, whether it's in Syria, whether it's in Libya, whether the latest theater of war has been Azerbaijan. So I think, like Mustafa was saying, a little bit of it towards the domestic. But I don't think it's that much, because the next one is really, the next election is 2023, right? So there's nothing really to fight here. I do think it's bashing out an image for the long term, for the medium term.
Janice Jabor, you agree?
Yeah, sure. Actually, the decision to turn Hagia Sophia into a mosque is primarily a political move that is aimed at achieving mainly two objectives. First of all, given that Erdogan has in mind the preparation of the 2023 presidential elections, he is trying through this decision to consolidate his power base by appealing to hardline Islamists, meaning those Islamists who used to vote not for the ruling Justice and Development Party, whom they perceive as too moderate, but who actually used to vote for more far-right Islamist parties like the SADC. And actually, these Islamists, hardline Islamists, believe that the true identity of Turkey is a Muslim identity, and that the true history of Turkey actually starts not in 1923 with the founding of the Turkish Republic by Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, but rather it starts in 1453, which is the date of the conquest of Constantinople by Mehmed the Conqueror and his decision to convert Hagia Sophia from a cathedral into a mosque. And maybe the second very important political objective for Erdogan through this decision is to reshape Turkish national identity by reasserting Turkey's belonging to the Islamic civilization. I mean, in a way, symbolically, this decision means the triumph of Islam over Christianity in a sort of revived clash of civilization and confrontation with the West. Now, what's really sad is that it is Turkey who in 2006 co-launched with Spain the initiative of the Alliance of Civilizations, who is now in 2020 turning Hagia Sophia, the symbol of universality, into a mosque.
Yusuf Erim, you've heard there first Mustafa Akyol wonder aloud why Recep Tayyip Erdoğan changed his mind. And now Jana Jabour, who's disagreeing there with Henry Hopwood Phillips to a degree. Henry Hopwood Phillips, who thinks it's a lot about foreign policy, whereas Jana is saying it's about defining himself in front of his own electorate. Why this change of stance by Turkey's president?
Well, first of all, I want to correct the guest before. Turkish history didn't start in 1453. There's been over 16 reiterations of the Turkish state throughout history, dating back to the Seljuks and going even much further back to the steppes of Asia. So a very rich history for the Turks, dating back a couple thousand years. When it goes back to why now and what does this mean for Erdogan, we have to realize that this wasn't a recent decision. This wasn't even a political decision. This was a judicial decision that began, the process began back in 2005. So it's been 15 years in the Turkish judiciary going back and forth from the Council of State to the Constitutional Court and whatnot. So this is not something that's been timed. And if it has been timed, it's been 15 years in the making. So I highly doubt someone had the foresight back in 2005.
Why was President Erdogan against turning it back into a mosque 2 years ago and now he's for it?
I don't think he was against turning it back. I just think that he might have seen the negative side to it, maybe the way it might be viewed by the Western world as it's being viewed right now. So at the end of the day, like I said, it is a judicial decision. It's not a decision to revert Hagia Sophia back into a mosque, first thing. It's annulling a 1934 decision as illegal, hence the reversion back to a mosque. And when we look at this decision, there is jurisprudence, there is legal evidence regarding this. You have a title deed by Mehmet the Conqueror, you have a foundation it was endowed to, and with the explicit direction to keep this as a mosque. So as Mustafa Akyol stated in the beginning, this 1934 decision was a very political decision. Is the 2020 decision political? Well, it was a judicial decision. Did President Erdogan have the power under the executive presidency to supersede any court decision and do this himself? That depends. That you have to examine his presidential powers. He might have been able to hammer this through and gotten even more points with his electorate if he wanted to. But he let the judiciary, which was a 15-year process, make this decision. And hence we are where we are today.
Is that your reading of what happened, Mustafa Akyol?
Well, technically, it is true. There is now a legal decision by the Council of State, but we know that in Turkey, if President Erdogan doesn't like a court decision, he publicly speaks against it, and you don't even expect court decisions that would really go against his political line, unfortunately, in the past couple of years. So there is some politics to it. And I'm not going to try to read President Erdogan's mind, but a lot of people think that it has something to do with consolidating the base. It is true, though. I mean, it's not something new in Turkey. Reopening Hagia Sophia as a mosque has been the dream of Turkey's religious conservatives. And you should understand their emotions. And I think we should understand the fact that Turkey's conservatives have a legitimate problem with aspects of the secular past. Mustafa Kemal Atatürk was mentioned a few times here. Yes, he brought some very good reforms and he established a republic, like, you know, good reforms for equal rights for women. But his secularism was an illiberal one, which included banning of religious practices and institutions. Also, it was very nationalist, and the denial of Kurds, for example, is a legacy of Atatürk, not the Ottoman Empire. So there were things that had to be corrected. And I think in the earlier years, President Erdogan and his party were correcting the problematic parts. But this is coming growingly into a kind of revenge and take back and kind of domination in reverse, because under Atatürk, Turkey was dominated by the secularists. Now it's being dominated in reverse, and people like me would like to see real pluralism. So I see the Hagia Sophia affair as a lost chance, a chance that Turkey could have shown to the world that it cares for its Muslim majority, but the Christian minority and their emotions and their historical ties to the building. Unfortunately, that's not the case. On the other hand, I would like to say that we would be wrong to think this as a cross versus crescent clash of civilizations. That is precisely some, you know, hot-headed people in Turkey believe, but that is not the message I think we should deepen in the world. In Muslims, Hagia Sophia will pray. They point to Cordoba Mosque, where only Christians pray, but not Muslims. The mosque, which was turned into a cathedral. The world history is full of buildings like this that are sacred. And I'm sad that Turkey lost an opportunity, but this should not be a reason to add more to the idea of clash of civilizations or clash of religions.
Henry Hopwood Phillips, you heard there Mustafa Akil mention the mosque/cathedral in Cordoba, Spain, where the Catholic Church has rejected a request by the local Muslim community to allow it to pray there. Your thoughts about the parallels that are made between Cordoba and Hagia Sophia?
I would love to paint a kind of comparative history in which one sense justifies the other. And in all honesty, I think both sides are in the wrong. I actually do believe that when either nation, whether it's Spain or Turkey, goes down the path of religious triumphalism, I think it basically puts everyone else on a short tether. I mean, I would personally think that if Erdogan wants to go down this route, you're really risking, look at Russia to its north. I think it plays a much cleverer game by building these great, beautiful mosques, like in Moscow 5 years ago. I think it's weirdly called the Great Mosque Cathedral. Don't know what happened to the translations there. But it basically very cleverly co-opts its minority Muslim sentiment into the nation state. Now, imagine if Russia reversed that policy and started crushing, or let's say converting, some of its most beautiful mosques, like the 8th century Juma Mosque in Dagestan. I just don't think Erdogan's looking at what happens if anyone else plays that same game. But I don't condone Spain either. I don't actually think it's particularly great to do what it's done with Cordoba. Having said that, there is one justification, which is, don't forget, Muslims also conquered Cordoba. So it was a church beforehand. So there was a Christian prehistory, if you like, to the mosque.
Yeah, Janet Jabor, there is one more layer of domestic politics that perhaps we should look at here. Hagia Sophia is in Istanbul, where in municipal elections, it was the opposition that won. Is this also a way for Recep Tayyip Erdoğan to send a message to his base that he is against those elitist Istanbulites with the heartland?
Obviously, it's another more layer that adds to this decision. In fact, the decision doesn't matter for the average Turk in the country today. It doesn't even matter for the Muslim practicing Turk, the average Muslim practicing Turk, because Turks in their big majority have interiorized secularism in a way or another, and they are secular in the sense that they do not want Islam to be the main pillar of societal organization, and they don't want Islam to be a main driver of legislation in the country. So basically, this decision is not meant at addressing a message to just any Turk in the country, but mainly to the opposition, showing that after all, Istanbul, the city of Recep Tayyip Erdoğan, the city which elected him first mayor in the late 1990s, and later allowing him to become prime minister of Turkey and president, is still his own city. He has a sort of control, sovereign control, of what to do in the city and what status to give to the major monument and symbolic monuments in the city.
All right, our panel talking earlier about how this reconversion stings particularly with the Orthodox, Christian Orthodox community. Hagia Sophia considered, some say, the equivalent of St. Peter's Basilica for the Catholics. Let's listen to the Greek Prime Minister speaking earlier this month.
Απέναντι σε αυτήν την αχρίαστη, μικρόψυχη πρωτοβουλία της Τουρκίας, η Ελλάδα μελετά την αντίδρασή της σε όλα τα επίπεδα. Σε κάθε περίπτωση όμως, το σύμβολο, αυτό το σύμβολο της ειρηνικής συνύπαρξης, της θρησκευτικής ανεκτικότητας και του πολιτισμού, δεν μπορεί να μείνει εχμάλωτος πολιτικών χειρισμών.
Yusufarib, your reaction.
Well, I understand that the Hagia Sophia is very important to the Greek Orthodox religion. And frankly, after tomorrow, when the first Friday prayer is held, nothing's going to change. Any Greek Orthodox that wants to come and visit the Hagia Sophia tomorrow or the day after, just as 2-3 weeks ago when its status was a museum, they'll be able to visit. They'll be able to enjoy the Christian icons, the mosaics, the frescoes. So there is no difference. Also, when we look at the status of many of the churches inside Turkey, whether it be the Iron Church of St. Stephen's in Istanbul, the one that Bulgarian Prime Minister Borisov opened up in 2018, one of the first churches in the world, the Cave Church of St. Peter in Hatay, the Hagia Sophia in Iznik, where the Second Council of Nicaea was held. It was actually burnt down by Greeks fleeing after the occupation of World War I of Turkey. So we've seen Turkey be, and its predecessor, the Ottomans, be very good stewards of these very important Christian artifacts, not just because Islam is a religion of tolerance, but also because Turkey understands how important this cultural heritage is. When we look at the Ottoman Empire, it's a melting pot of the region, of religions, of ethnicities. What the United States is today as a melting pot, the Ottoman Empire was 500 years ago, the same melting pot of the region, which basically was a pioneer in allowing religious freedoms. That's why many of these churches are still up in Istanbul and around Turkey today, are 435 of them to be exact. So I don't agree with the Greek Prime Minister's concerns that anything's gonna happen to the cultural identity of Hagia Sophia. It was always a house of worship. It's continuing as a house of worship. Whether 900 years as a Greek Orthodox church, the 60 years as a Roman Catholic cathedral, the 500 years as a mosque, it doesn't matter. It's a special place and it'll continue to be a special place. And as you said at the beginning of the show, it transcends time. It is a very majestic place and rightfully named the Holy Wisdom, Hagia Sophia.
The Turkish government saying it's going to cover those Christian frescoes and mosaics, the ones that point towards Mecca during a Friday prayer. Do you agree with the assessment you just heard from Yusuf, Henry Hopwood Phillips?
No, probably charitable to say not. Basically, I think it's insincere to argue that Turkey is a particularly good custodian of Christian sites when there were, you know, let's say churches could be measured in the thousands in the 15th to 17th centuries. And now you're looking at fewer than 200. I mean, you don't have to be good at math to work out the fraction on that one. But more to the point, I think here we've got a massive cleavage between, let's say, Islam, what it actually says, and the Islamic identity, the caricature, if you like, that's being presented by the likes of Erdogan. I think if you actually look at Islam, it is quite tolerant towards Christianity. If you go back to the 7th century, the Treaty of Najran was actually, it guaranteed Christians their freedom of religion, their security of property. No cross will be destroyed or harmed, no venue, basically a church. And jumping right to the end of Islam, its eschatology, its end time theories, you've got countless hadith that basically argue that don't upset the Rum, which is the old name basically for the Orthodox, because the Muslims believe that they'll make an alliance with them against that essentially an evil army that will lay behind them, and they will together be victorious. There's basically a giant gap, a kind of epistemic distance between the caricature that Erdogan wants to present and the reality of Islam, and it's just farcical to me.
Mustafa Akil, there's also cleavages within Islam. At Friday's ceremony, we're due to see the Emir of Qatar. Of course, we won't be seeing those that oppose the Qataris from the Muslim world.
Yeah, I mean, some celebrities are invited to Hagia Sophia, and I think that's normal. Turkey invites the ones that clothes itself. On that issue, though, on Christianity and Islam, I agree with parts of what Yusuf said and Henry said, most of what they said. It is indeed remarkable that Islam, when it was born in 7th century Arabia, didn't delegitimize Christianity or Judaism. And Muslims conquered the world. And I find that conquering, not as a part of religion, but as a part of imperial world in which Islam was born, which everybody was doing that. Islam actually didn't convert many churches. That's why when you go to Jerusalem, you still find churches like the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which was conquered by Muslims, but Muslims didn't touch it. There are great stories about Caliph Umar actually preventing any conversion. And it is true that in the Ottoman Empire, Christians and Jews, by the way, who fled from Europe when they were persecuted in Spain, found more tolerance, more space under the Ottomans than some of the absolutist Catholic or Christian kingdoms at the time. However, the Ottoman tolerance was a bit hegemonic, which was, again, quite enlightened at the time compared to total persecution. But Muslims were rulers and superiors, and they were tolerating Jews and Christians with some lesser rights. That changed in the Tanzimat, the modern reform era in the 19th century, and Ottomans ultimately accepted equal citizenship, which was a great thing for the, I think, Islamic civilization. Now, my worry is that by focusing on Hagia Sophia, making it such a powerful symbol and converting it back to a mosque, Turkey is not representing the values of Tanzimat, that is equality for Christians and Jews and Muslims and whomever, but rather the more hegemonic age. And that is unfair. It's true that this government opened some mosques, some churches and synagogues. This government, Erdogan's government, gave back to non-Muslims some of the properties that was confiscated, and it was a part of the EU reform agenda. But with Hagia Sophia, we're just seeing the idea that Muslims are hegemonic and they're converting places again. And it was normal for the 15th century, but it was not a component of Islam. Islamically, it could be disputed. And I think while it was normal for the 15th century, it is not something that we need in the 21st century.
Jana Jabour, you're sitting in Beirut, which used to be part of the Ottoman Empire. What's the view where you are towards this reconversion?
Well, there are two views, and the Lebanese and more broadly speaking, the Arab public opinion is split among two camps. You have the majority of Muslims, Sunni Muslims in Lebanon, but I would say also in the Arab world, who are cheering for Recep Tayyip Erdoğan because he converted Hagia Sophia into a mosque, considering that this is really a blow to the West and a reassertion of Turkey's true identity after one century of secularism imposed, illiberal secularism in the country. And on the other hand, you have Christians who actually consider this decision as a humiliation for them, and who don't really understand the rationale behind it, and who consider that after all, with this decision, Turkey and President Recep Tayyip Erdoğan are revealing what they call their true face, so Erdoğan's true face, which is the Islamist face.
Yeah, Turkey's place in the region, it's not just a question of religion. It's a lot of question about politics these days. Ankara this week announcing it was going to keep a presence in northern Syria. And then there's the growing tension over Libya, with the Egyptian parliament drawing a red line, saying if Turkish-backed government forces there enter the city of Sirte, they give themselves the right to intervene.
فطبقا لميثاق الامم المتحده من حق الدوله المصريه ان تدافع عن نفسها، ثم طبقا لاتفاقيه الدفاع المشترك العربي المشترك الموجوده في ميثاق جامع الدول العربيه ايضا تعطينا هذا.
مصطفى اكيول, this is not happening in a vacuum, is it, this reconversion of Hagia Sophia? What is Turkey's place in the region these days?
Turkey growingly has seen itself as part of a big regional confrontation. On the one side, there's Turkey and Qatar. On the other side, there is the Sisi regime in Egypt, UAE, the forces, and the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, the forces that are against the Arab Spring tide in the region. And I see very often Turkey in this confrontation being defined as with the Islamists, which is partly true. Turkey supports Muslim Brotherhood and affiliated groups in the region generally in this conflict. However, we should see that the other camp also is supported by or includes in Libya as well, groups called Salafis, which are actually tougher, more hardline Islamists than the Islamists we're speaking about. The only reason them being preferred is they're loyal to the Arab monarchies, the autocratic Arab monarchies. And this confrontation between Turkey and Qatar and the other actors I mentioned in the region is leading to narrations. And I see a lot of narratives in the West about how Turkey is reviving Islamism and so on and so forth. But that narrative in itself has a political agenda, because the countries that are criticizing Turkey in this regard are quite despotic. And I think the Egyptian regime in Turkey is way more authoritarian and brutal than, unfortunately, growing the authoritarian system in Turkey. So I think we should be fair and factual. There are countries with power struggles. Turkey has some understandable interests. And I think outside powers, like European powers, like France, should try to find peaceful solutions to the conflict in France and the general tension in the region, rather than supporting one side, that is the UAE and Egyptian side, and demonizing Turkey as the dark side.
Yusuf Erim, again, that list of places where Turkey has a stake in the fight now is long. It as you just heard Henry Hopwood Phillips earlier say, it's growing longer if they're taking sides when it comes to the tensions between Azerbaijan and Armenia. Is Turkey overstretched?
No, it's not. And I think Turkey's foreign policy right now is a coming of age. Turkey's ready to be the regional leader, ready to be a leader in the MENA region. And I think there has been a great divide since the Arab Spring. If we can look at one moment that truly divided and created these axes that we see today, with Turkey and Qatar on one side and the GCC trio of Sisi, MBS, and MBZ on the other side, this Turkish and Qatari support for pluralistic movements throughout MENA, whether it be in Tunisia, whether it be in Egypt, whether it be in Libya or Syria, and the trio of UAE, Saudi, and Egypt backing the regimes, the more authoritarian regimes. Now, unfortunately, I think Europe is reading this completely wrong, thinking that these authoritarian regimes can provide security and stability. That's only on the surface, but deep down inside society, there's a tremendous turmoil bubbling in many of these countries. And this is only going to be solved with a shift towards pluralism. Now, we're seeing Turkey over the years strengthen itself from a manufacturing aspect, from a defense industry aspect, a military aspect. And Turkey's going to continue to project power in this region and try to further its national interests as long as the Turkish president feels he can keep himself on the right side of history in every one of these conflicts. So we're seeing Turkey support the Syrian opposition in Syria against the dictator Assad. We're seeing Turkey support the UN-recognized government in Libya against the warlord Khalifa Haftar. And as long as, I said, President Erdogan can keep himself on the right side of history and project this power, he'll continue to do so, because Turkey is unfortunately held to a very, very tough standard that many other countries are not held to. So being on the right side and having defensible arguments, having legitimate arguments, defending democracy, defending legitimate governments, this is very important for Turkey as it continues to stretch its arms out into the MENA region, deeper and deeper, not only into the GCC and the Gulf, but also deeper into Africa, into Sahel and the Maghreb.
All right, let me bring in Henry Hopwood Phillips, a historian. So let's take the long view on this. Take the long view, for instance, on the growing tension between Turkey and Egypt. Is Libya the reason or the excuse?
I think Libya is an excuse. I would actually drag in Libya. Libya actually creates more problems, even though it is the excuse, which is you're treading on the toes, if you like, of the EU, because the EU's wanted a pipeline to go from Israel, Cyprus, up towards Italy. And effectively, Turkey's trying to bypass that via Libya. Hence the French participation in selling Greece two frigates recently. Basically, it's kind of creating a black hole that's sucking more and more actors in. Before, everyone could say, oh, poor Greece, isn't it sad, and do nothing. Whereas now people are actually seeing more of their rights being infringed. I mean, you just have to look. When Yusuf says Turkey's coming of age, I mean, it can only be considered to, what, coming of age to the schoolyard bully. I mean, if we're looking at Greece, they've infringed Greek airspace something like 4,800 times this year. I mean, it's become a joke. Dogfights in the air 400 times. Violation of Greek waters 15 times higher than 2010. These stats are insane. We've just got so used to it that we're pretending Turkey's acting like a normal player, but it's not. That's what I'd say.
Janet Jabor, could it spiral out of control?
Under the rule of the Justice and Development Party and President Erdogan in particular, Turkey has embraced a very ambitious and a very active, proactive foreign policy, a policy of national aggrandizement, and a diplomacy that is aimed really at allowing Turkey to get more autonomy, more independence, and more sovereignty in world affairs. So Turkey today, and this is where I do not really agree with Yusuf, I think that Turkey is really today deployed on too many fronts. So Turkey is indeed overstretched. And the problem is that today the Turkish military, for example, doesn't have the real capacities to sustain a long-term presence in fronts like Libya or Syria, and at the same time, the shores of Greece. So at the end of the day, time might play against Turkey. Now, the second issue of Turkish foreign policy today is that because Turkey wanted to be a regional player, it engaged, and in a way or another, it was driven to engage in proxy wars, be it in Syria or in Libya. And the problem is that Turkey doesn't really have expertise or know-how in this particular type of warfare. So Turkey is discovering what proxy warfare is all about. And eventually, the game might backfire.
One final question, because we're running short on time. I'll put it to you, Mustafa Akyol. Here in Paris, when Notre Dame burned, citizens surprised even themselves, those that were staunchly secular, those that weren't even Christian, to realize just how much they identified with that structure. At the end of the day, whatever happens, will Turks take the fate of Hagia Sophia in stride?
We will see. Sofia is not being destroyed. We should grant that. And the Christian imagery will be there still, although they will be covered during the prayer. And how that will work is something we should see. I certainly believe in preserving the dual heritage of Hagia Sophia as much as possible, despite it will serve as a mosque. There's still a chance that, you know, a more enlightened view in Turkey may allow Christian worship at some part of the building. The Armenian Patriarch asked for that a few weeks ago. And regarding whether Turkey is coming of age regarding its foreign policy, I think Turkey had come of age 10 years ago when it was speaking about zero problems with neighbors and trying to mediate between different actors in the Middle East. Unfortunately, it's not very wise in some of the steps it has been taken. However, again, this is not a reason to think that Turkey is a troublemaker in the region and Egypt, UAE. These countries, or Saudi Arabia, are countries that are supposedly more democratic or liberal than Turkey. That is not the case. I hope to see a Turkey that is more mature, both in foreign policy and domestic, which is less divisive at home and which is more diplomatic abroad. But we will reach that by not isolating Turkey or by not taking sides with certain governments who are actually more authoritarian. And who have their own axe to grind against some elected groups in the region.
And that'll be the final word. I want to thank you so much, Mustafa Akil, for joining us from Washington, Yusuf Harim in Istanbul, Jana Jabour in Beirut, Henry Hopwood Phillips in London. Thank you for joining us here in the France 24 debate. Much more on our website, france24.com.
Fake news, noun. False stories that appear to be news, spread on the internet or using other media. At France 24, our job is to provide you with information that's been verified. We check sources, we check facts, we sort what is true from what is fake.
At the France 24 Observers, we verify photos and videos circulating online. If they're fake, we let you know and tell you how we spotted them.
In Fact or Fake, we dig into viral stories around Europe to shake out the truth from the trash.
Every day, the Info Migrants team scours social networks to fight fake news about the reality of migration.
France 24, news based on facts.
Liberté, égalité, actualité.